apologize, we walk in darkness. I love God, and we love God in the truth. If we walk in the light, and the things of God is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we die, we have nothing, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say, we have nothing, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. My own children, I am writing to you these things so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He Himself is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for us, but for those out in the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
took a house, fed together. You would have seen these words. You now teach you this. Second point, what does a time mean? Or a time month mean? Did anybody use that word in a conversation this week? But it's a biblical word, it's not a word word. And don't you feel this way because God was angry? Or because he loves us? That's a very, very important question that we need to ask together today. Let's pray and we'll jump right in. Lord Jesus, as we open up your word now, I pray that your spirit would illuminate it. I pray that you would do something significant in us. I pray that you would revitalize and refresh us. I pray that we would believe this. I pray that we would be able to hold the barriers of life, but that we would put out of us in the truth of the biblical text as you are showing it to us today. May you read my words as well as us. May you open up our hearts so that we can hear it clearly. Help us to leave whatever lies behind us or whatever lies before us. And help us to be very present. First point, there are plans for youth and sacrifice. Together, I mean, this Sunday, I had to go on excerpt of some of the verses we read, the bold and underlying, the original for the biblical text, I put it in there for you. Look at the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin, verse 7. And then 2 verse 2, he himself is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. So cleanse, purify, clean up, forgive for whatever dirty the relationship. But then, a sacrifice, all go together. Let me invite you to the table. After your weekly food illustration, let's pray we go for a burger. I mean, that's the good part that day. Let's ask somebody to get up. It's like a good thing to get up to. I'm just joking. Let's go for a burger. Sit down. We order burgers. We enjoy it. Smell them all. Great conversation, very encouraging. We go from pleasantries and small talk all the way down to how I feel and how you feel. We make a deep connection with one another. What a phenomenal time. When it's all done, I'm just going to say, I forgot about what. Sorry. My bad. I can't play forever. So I'm going to walk right between us now. Because I think that's something that dirty the relationship. I mean, the relationship was good. We agreed that we're going to food. We agreed that each one is going to pay for himself. And by the first week, the whole bill on the burgers. Right? So we made about 115, 120 a hamburger. He said he was going to pay myself. And he did not. So there's a problem between us now. And next time you're welcome to the bill, okay? And he said, I forgive you for the fact that you forgot your word. I forgive you for the awkwardness that you caused between us. This is the law. Now, just keep on forgiving. And you may be good. But the only thing that's going to come over here is, here's your bubble. You need to pray more. Can you understand if you would say to the way that person, he forgot his word? And I just want you to know that I'm still forgiving. And we are good. The matter is going to say, well, thank you very much for the long Christian witness. I do appreciate that. You need to pray. Why? Because you wanted something. And you took it. And you ate it. And therefore, you have to pray. The first thing I was saying, when you pray, it has been given. Is a
if Jesus has a fellowship with you, and yet we walk in darkness, we come running and not practicing the truth. Last week, when they sent me some of the reasons to the message, I'm just reading what it says. And I said, I'm going to tell you to say that. This is what the Bible says. Look at what I say. If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves. And the truth is not in us. Verse 10, if we say we have not sin, we are a liar. And the yet we have not in us. Look at verse 1 chapter 2. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. That's also the truth. If I say that the light triumphs, that might be something. So what would you do? Because the Bible is gonna come. But John says to us that there is a way out. There is something that could cover for you. Think about the rest of the assumption again. The only way that the Bible is going to be settled is if you say to me, I'll come for you. I will not pay your part of the Bible. There's no getting out. So I need you to sacrifice extra to give me what I do not deserve, because I knew the rules before I came. And then for you to cover it for me with the word. And to say, regardless of what you think of him, I will pay his part. John says in the same way, we have one God. There's nothing that can cover for us. Because I mean, we just let these negative mountains. This puts us in a very dire situation. But then John says there's a way out. There's something that can cover for you. John could have used financial language, like sticking the bomb, or paying the balance, or paying what was owed. He could have done that. You have words in Greek vocabulary, John wrote in Greek, that he could have used. If that was the essence of what it means to come up with, he didn't. John also could have used a relational language, like the reconciliation, or forgiveness and acceptance, or repentance, but he doesn't. John uses language that comes from the Old Testament. Just in 2 verse 2, he uses the words atoning sacrifice. That's very, very interesting. And that's a word that has its root in the Old Testament. Okay, so that's how cleanse, forgive, and sacrifice fit together. But let's look at the second one. What does atoning or atonement mean? So you can actually pass means unraveling a word into syllables or roots. You can actually pass the word atonement into atonement. Okay, that's not word gymnastics, but you'll find it in the dictionary like that. And that's the specific meaning it means to make a right or to reconcile. To bring two parties that are not in arms with one another at one. To make at one moment between two opposing things. The Greek word is hilasos, and the Hebrew word is kibbeh. Well, I'm going to give you both of those words. Well, the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, the New Testament was written in Greek. John knew the Old Testament scriptures like literally of his whole heart. He spoke Hebrew and Aramaic, but the language of the time that he wrote in was Greek. So he wants to use Old Testament Hebrew language, but then write it in Greek so that you can understand it. It's a very puzzling word, but that's the word. He lasts us in Greek and better in Hebrew. But I'm thinking about it. Didn't you actually also use the word he lasts us last week? Well, in one of the scriptures here, you did it. It might be in a previous sermon. So here's the point of reading it. To cover someone's failure. I don't know what that. I can't. To erase debt. I erase something and you erase no debt form. To purify the relationship. Because remember when we started out the tunnel, we had to work through the awkwardness that I forgot about. And we had to cleanse what I made That's what it means. Okay. Now, let's get into the time machine. And let's get into the Old Testament to be a book that's called the Temple. I'm going to put an image on for you. It's like my rendition or my God of what a tabernacle might have looked like. Okay, but get your head into the wilderness and get your head into a tent. That's why we need to know if we want to understand what a tabernacle or what a tabernacle means. But up until that point, when Israel met with God in that place called the tabernacle, we have had the creation, God created everything good, putting it in its place. For the selection of all things and all people, giving humans a very specific job, just a new creation, just do it differently. We've seen Adam and Eve fall into sin. We've seen God dying again with the family of Noah. We've seen God dying again with the family of Abraham. This is the beginning chapters of Genesis. We saw that God entered into a promise with Abraham called a covenant, a really, really important deal in which there's no way I will sex or death or something or someone. We promised Paul, Abraham and his son Isaac, to Isaac's two sons, Jacob and Esau. We've seen Joseph, one of the sons of Jacob. We've seen the story of how and his eyes all ended up in Egypt. We saw how Pharaoh put them under a serious, serious bondage of slavery. We saw the rise of Moses. We saw Moses leading the people out of slavery in Egypt through the Red Sea. This place called the wilderness. We saw God giving his law to Moses. We saw God giving him his Ten Commandments, saying, if we want to be together, if I am your God and you are my people, this is how we are going to roll. And we also saw that the people of God forgot very, very quickly what it is that they were supposed to be. They were in a golden calf. They were in an idol worship very, very soon after God's sin. And then God approaches them and says, we need to do some work here. Okay? That is why we will meet in my place and my space. And this is why we will teach you who is you and who you are. And who you are. Because if you are a leader, I am different than everyone else. I am your fate as an adult. I am your family. And if you used to be the same. You should be different. You should be holy. There is a We know how much our sin breaks everything that God made good. And that's why God gave them the law. So it's in this place where people are cleansed. It's in this place where we saw forgiveness. It's in this place where we saw sacrifices. It's in this place in the Old Testament where we saw atonement happen. Because that's how it works. You have to say something. It's the burden that they saw. But it's also through our sin. You must see something dirty and then you need to be cleansed. You also need forgiveness. And you also need to pay. And we make this possible through the practice of animal sacrifice. But we make this practice as a way for people to be covered, as a way for people to have their sins erased, as a way for people to be purified. Do you guys get it? But that's all this about the tabernacle. Let me show you a different image. You've also seen this image before. So in this big courtyard in the front, but if we get over the next slide, please, I appreciate that. You'll see that it is marked. So if you enter the last garden, there is a lot. These are all the shorter tunnels, and that's called the brazen altar. Okay? Not too sure what kind of wood they used, but it was really, really strong. This is where sacrifice happened. Now, obviously, in the first one, the tabernacle sacrifice also happened, but we won't be going into that today. I just want you to get the picture that you took an animal and you burned it on the altar after it was slaughtered on these plants. That's how it worked. So, the process for this huge
Exodus chapter
17, verse 11. For my flesh, all creature,
is in the blood. And I have appointed it to you to make a tabernacle of the altar for your lives, so that it is the life blood that makes it home.
Because
that's God knows. That's what you might want to know today. God loves. He's such an extent that he might wait for you to cover all of those things. Let's give you a third one. Doesn't Jesus delay because God was angry? Or because he loves us? This is a very, very important question. Because as Christians, we have grappled with the wrath of God and his righteous anger. And most of the times, non-Christians deem God to be an angry God who throws temper tantrums, who can never be pleased. Now let me just put this to you. That is not the God that we read about in the Bible. That is a gross, gross, gross impression of the God of the Bible. And it's a good mistake we make, especially if we live in this paradox of life. We have to find ourselves thinking, I might have gone too far. This might have been one time too many. Let's go back to the restaurant, show my elbows. Can you imagine if you forget your wallet every time? Thank you. coming up. I'm going to pray for us. I just need to take care of that. We need to see that. I need to pray. Oh, that's my day. Come on. We're going to finish well. Let's pray. Jesus, the word thank you is actually really inadequate to say how we feel when we think of the love that you have for us. To be all that I am being killed, to be all that is what we do on a daily basis in our sin. And to know that you have what kills for us so that we don't ever have to pay our karma. That's good news. That is good. And we want to accept that through faith this morning. We want to live